Well, that's why in Ireland we loved Muhammad Ali, because it was a sin to think you were good. Like in Ireland at that time, to be a good Catholic, you had to think badly about yourself. You had to have no self-esteem to be a good Catholic. But it was the same in America. The racism thing meant those people had no self-esteem. So that's why Muhammad Ali was so powerful, and Irish people adore Muhammad Ali to this day.
Because he said, no,
because he was jumping around going, oh, I'm fucking great, I'm beautiful, I'm pretty, you know, I'm brilliant. And even the little children were like, oh my God, he's so amazing, because he was so naughty, you know. So.
Ok, beh, al tempo certo la religione non aiutava ad aumentare l'autostima in se stessi, e io adoro Muhammad Ali perché comunque lui ha cercato di spronare le persone a fare il contrario, cioè a credere in se stesse, ad elevare la propria autostima. Ecco perché il mio amore per questo personaggio. Non ha molto a che vedere con la musica, ma ve lo volevo proprio dire perché mi sgorga dall'anima.
We're talking about life, ma non solo.
Well, Muhammad Ali is my biggest hero ever, right? And I went to a party one time. It was a Bon Jovi after a show party, and John Bon Jovi says to me, "Oh, I'm going to meet Muhammad Ali tomorrow." It was the Special Olympics we're on in Ireland. And he said, "Oh, I'm going to meet." I was like, "Oh my God, I can't believe it." And he said, "Oh, you like him?" And he said, "Oh, get me in to see him." So I was like, yeah, right. And the next day I got a phone call. So myself and my son Jake, who was about 16 at the time, we went to meet Muhammad Ali at this hotel in Dublin. And so when I got in the room, he's sitting in the chair and he goes, because he loves the women. So I was like, oh my God, I get to kiss Muhammad Ali. So that was really good. But then, I don't know how this happened. He was doing all tricks for my son to make him laugh. He was able to do this trick where he somehow made it look like both his feet were coming off the ground. It was only one, but he was able to look like he was hovering over the ground. But then, I don't know why this happened, but myself and my son actually alone escorted Muhammad Ali to the Special Olympics. And we spent the whole night there with him, you know. And at one point, I had to walk him down to a scene. It was very funny because there was Nelson Mandela and there was Muhammad Ali. So you had your Mandela people and you had your Ali people, and we were strictly Ali, you know. And so at one point I had to walk him down to where he was sitting. He couldn't get his jacket on. He asked me, would I help him? I was like, oh my God, I can't, like, couldn't believe it. And then I sat beside him for the whole night and everything. But then the most beautiful thing I've ever seen in my life is an image that always stick with me for the rest of my life, because Irish people love the man so much that when we were leaving, it was at the back of this major sports stadium, when we were leaving passing all the dressing rooms in the corridor, there was a doorway like this, and we were passing it. All there was women's faces all crying, just because they loved Muhammad Ali so much. He meant so much to Irish people because of the whole self-esteem issue, you know? So there must have been 100 women's faces in the whole thing, every one of them crying their eyes out. Like.
Okay.
Sorry, this was happening where?
Yeah, it was about 7 years ago in Ireland, yeah.
In Ireland?
Yeah.
Durante i Giochi Olimpici.
Yeah.
A proposito di Muhammad Ali, una sera mi sono incontrata con Bon Jovi, era il periodo dei giochi, delle Olimpiadi, e alla sera quando l'ho incontrato lui mi ha detto, sai chi vedo domani? Domani incontro Muhammad Ali. Gli ho detto, no, non ci credo, ma come, ma ti prego, fammi chiamare, fammi contattare. E così il giorno dopo ho ricevuto una chiamata da Muhammad Ali che mi ha contattato. Io ero con mio figlio Jake e siamo andati a trovarlo. È incredibile come sia piaciuto anche a mio figlio, faceva questi giochi, no? Lo intratteneva, e quindi mio figlio gli dava anche dei baci. Diciamo che in occasione di quei giochi era anche prevista la presenza di Mandela, e io e mio figlio abbiamo scortato Muhammad Ali alle Olimpiadi, quindi c'erano quelli che scortavano Mandela e stavano con Mandela, e noi invece che facevamo il tifo eravamo abbracciati a Muhammad Ali. E poi mi ricordo un'immagine di una scena, ecco, di quell'occasione. Uscendo da questo grande stadio, in un corridoio ho visto 100 più immagini di volti di donne che piangevano, e questo è stato sicuramente dal punto di vista emotivo forte per me. Comunque questo ha a che vedere con la figura di Muhammad Ali e la sua volontà di accrescere l'autostima delle donne, degli individui e delle donne.
I have two more funny things. One was he out of his briefcase, he had a whole collection of these Bible contradictions, He spent his life making a list of Bible contradictions, and he gives them out to everybody, you know. But then another brilliant thing happened. He was sitting in the dressing room, and he drew a big picture on a tablecloth like this, and two big mountains with a big ship sailing through them. And then on the other side, one of his boxing matches, but there was a young Irish soldier driving him. And me and the soldier were like, "You're going down. No, you're going down." We were both fighting over the tablecloth. In the end, I got it. But I kept up, made friends with the soldier, so... I still have the tablecloth, but I can't put it up, obviously, because someone would steal it, you know, so...
Okay, sorry. So the image, you had two mountains
with a big ship sailing through them.
Yeah, and where are the soldiers?
Well, no, the soldier was driving Muhammad Ali, the Irish soldier.
Oh, okay.
He was his driver for the night. But when we both saw Muhammad Ali drawing on the tablecloth, we were like, "No, I'm getting it. No, fuck you, I'm getting it," you know. So we had a bit of a row over who got it.
Sì, la tela.
Infatti. Una delle cose, diciamo, più interessanti che volevo condividere con voi è che, appunto, in una valigetta Muhammad Ali teneva tutte le contraddizioni presenti nel testo sacro, e insomma questo, diciamo, che è degno di nota. Poi
parliamo della Bibbia.
Sì.
Non ha
riferito niente di speciale, ha soltanto detto che lui annotava le contraddizioni presenti nella Bibbia. Esatto. E poi quando appunto era insieme a Muhammad Ali aveva iniziato a fare un disegno, c'erano due montagne e in mezzo c'era una nave, no? Veniva scortato a Muhammad Ali dalla polizia irlandese quando comunque eravamo in macchina, diciamo che ci stavamo comunque contendendo questo disegno.
Che poi alla fine ce l'ha avuto lei.
E poi alla fine ce l'ha avuto lei, che però poi appunto non può mostrarlo per paura che le venga preso da qualcuno.
Allora, siccome dobbiamo chiudere e ci abbiamo l'ultima domanda, mi sembra giusto chiedere qualcosa anche sul concerto di stasera e sul materiale che c'è. Cioè, per esempio, il riferimento all'ultimo album fatto dalla signora O'Connor, e che cosa contiene, quanto di quel materiale hai per esempio nel concerto, e che rapporto ha un po' con il materiale che presenta, perché vedo appunto c'è un po' di tutto. Cioè, anche alcune cose della carriera passata.
Okay, so basically we'd like to know which songs you are going to sing tonight and which of them are from the last album released.
Well, I'm going to do lots of songs off lots of different albums. There's let me see, there's probably five or so off the last album, which was called Theology, that was all all scriptures basically. And then obviously there's the one that everybody wants to hear, which is good, and I enjoy that. And then there's just different songs from different albums, like, so it's about an hour and a half or so, and then there's half an hour afterwards. Kind of.
Come ho detto all'inizio di questa conferenza, le canzoni che io canterò provengono da diversi comunque album. Mm-hmm. Ci sono almeno 5 canzoni che canterò che provengono dall'ultimo album, che è Theology, e poi naturalmente ci sarà la canzone che tutti vogliono sentire.
Sì, ma il discorso era un pochino su che cosa unisce, in fondo, attraverso le canzoni nuove, la Sinead O'Connor di oggi, con quella che abbiamo conosciuto all'inizio, a fine anni 80, inizio anni 90, qual è il filo musicale che tiene insieme tutto questo?
What's the connection between what we have seen of Sinead O'Connor in the past and what we see now of Sinead O'Connor now at present in the music? Is there a common wire, a common something that links?
I think
what's the link between you in the past and you now? And how are you going to express that in a concert?
Well, I suppose partly there's a link as a singer that, you know, when I listen to, say, my first two records, just singing, forgetting about the lyrics, I can kind of see someone who, like, again, when I grew up in Ireland, it was really uncool to sing in an Irish accent, for example. So, you know, the first two records I made, and it was the same with all Irish artists, you know, this is the first two records I made, I was there singing in an American accent, trying to sound like all the singers I liked. But then as I made more and more albums, I was able to become myself and sing in my own voice, you know. So there's a progression there as a singer, and obviously the thing in common is the singer is the same body, the same instrument, the same person, you know.
Ok, quindi praticamente il filo conduttore, la cosa in comune fra il passato e il presente è il cantante. Il cantante e chi lo accompagna. Poi naturalmente se devo guardare al passato, i primi due album, mi rivedo me cantare i primi due album e cercare di avere comunque un accento americano il più forte possibile, proprio perché era assolutamente diciamo poco alla moda cantare con un accento irlandese, mentre adesso comunque ho trovato me stessa e posso esprimere la mia identità liberamente, quindi posso esprimermi con un accento più irlandese.
Va bene, okay. You have to go, they told me.
Okay. Cool.
So, all right. Thank you so much. Cool.